doing here?
Oh, I'm just here because I thought we could do this together.
Well, I guess.
No, I thought it'd be quite nice. All right, let's do it together. Okay.
Okay.
Hello, my merry band of O-Satters.
And
welcome
to the
Sockmatician Podcast. Hello, my merry band of O-Satters, and welcome to this latest episode of the Sockmatician Podcast called Post Brass, for reasons which will become apparent in a very short while. It is currently the 1st of September. It's a beautiful late summer's sunny day out there. It's really quite warm, actually. It's about 3:30 in the afternoon, and Ben and I have had a busy day running around. I'll tell you more about that in a moment. And my name is Nathan Taylor, also known as Sockmatician, right here on Ravelry, Instagram, Twitter, and YouTube, and also now on Periscope. Some of you may have seen the last Periscope episode, or the only Periscope episode of Not a Podcast, a Sockmatician Periscope that I broadcast a few weeks ago. I hope to do some more of those soon. It's a kind of a fun experiment. Some people, I think, didn't enjoy watching it quite as much as they would enjoy watching a normal podcast. That's okay, it's a different beast. I think some people find the constant interruptions of the comments and the messages that flicker up the screen a little bit distracting, and it's certainly just kind of distracting for me as well, but that is, after all, what Periscope is. Otherwise I would just be sitting here burbling away as I am now, with, you know, just doing my own thing, whereas actually the joy of Periscope is that real-time interaction where people can ask questions. Of course, it does leave it open to being gatecrashed by people who might not be interested in what you have to say and might want to try and derail things just for fun. I can deal with that. And for the edited version of the Periscope that I put up on YouTube, I did take out some of the less salubrious comments, just in case people were watching. I didn't want people to get offended. So you can rest assured that if I am doing any Periscope episodes in the future, and I do put them up on YouTube for those who don't want to or can't watch on Periscope, then I will be making them completely family friendly. So panic not. How are you all? What have you been up to? It's summer. It's been very, very hot here in London. I don't know about the rest of the UK, really. I've been living in a bubble for a few weeks. And it's like really super, super hot, and probably a little bit too hot for joyful knitting. I'm a little bit sweaty of hand today, which is a little bit gross. I was knitting on the tube just now, and I was sort of... Normally, I tension my yarn around my little finger once, and then up over my forefinger, and then I flick, so I've got a loop of yarn here. Because my hands were a little bit moist, shall we say. Now, let's... tangent. The word moist has apparently just been voted by some dictionary study the UK's least favourite word, and I think that's absolutely ridiculous. It's become a thing that people have decided that moist is a word they don't like, rather than because moist is a word that actually causes a negative response, I think. It's become trendy not to like moist, probably because of its sexual connotations, I don't know. There are many, many worse words, and most of them have four letters rather than five, which would provoke a stronger reaction, and therefore would probably be said to be less popular words than moist. Moist is a very, very fine word. My hands are currently it. So there I was, knitting on the tube, and instead of wrapping my yarn around my little finger, I was just literally sort of just holding it sort of between my fingers a bit, and using the friction of the yarn against the stitches that were on the right-hand needle to provide enough drag to be able to tension it, and it was working absolutely fine. I was worried because I could feel that because of the sweat on my fingers, that it's very hot on the underground. It's really, really hot. Normally, if I'm in that situation at home, I would run straight to the bathroom. I would wash my hands in cool water, not cold, because then it forces another reaction and your hands start to sweat, but cool water with soap to get rid of the oils and the grease, and then I dry my hands thoroughly, and then I'm good to go again, and everything is nice. Great. Some people I know use corn starch. apparently it doesn't affect the knitting, doesn't interact with any dyes or anything, but I don't really like the idea of getting all dusty. So I would rather wash my hands in soap and water, dry them, waft them about in the air a bit, make sure that all the creases are nice and dry, and then carry on with nice, smooth hands. So yes, you can't do that on the underground, so I was forced to come up with another solution. So, this episode is called Post-Brass. So here's the roundup. As many of you know, my husband, Benjamin Till, has written the most incredible show called Brass, which was performed at the gorgeous, sumptuous Hackney Empire last weekend on Friday and Saturday. Sadly, there were just, I'm going to show you some photographs. Sadly, there were just three performances, Friday night and Saturday evening. And Saturday matinee, sorry, I'm trying to do two things at once, trying to find the pictures here. But it was absolutely electric. I'm showing, trying to find the picture of the Hackney Empire itself so that you can see just what this wonderful, sumptuous theatre looks like. It's designed by Frank Matcham, who is one of the finest theatre designers to ever walk the planet. And there it is in all its glory. It's a four-level theatre, and they decided in their wisdom just to sell tickets on the bottom two levels. It's quite a large space, and they didn't want people all spread out. They wanted a much more concentrated audience, because a concentrated audience tend to be more vociferous and enjoy things better. It's a little bit odd when you get into the psychology of an audience and their enjoyment of a show. You can have a very small theatre that seats 400 people, and it can be completely full, and it's only got 400 people in it, and that atmosphere will be electric. You get an 1,800-seater theatre with 400 people in it, and if it were the same 400 people watching the same show, you can guarantee they wouldn't enjoy it anywhere near enough, because there'd be 1,400 empty seats laughing at them, saying, oh, you want to be a bit self-conscious, all this space, you're just one of a few, whereas actually it's the same number of people. So what they wanted to do was create a much denser and more condensed audience, and oh my goodness, the audiences just loved it. Ben and I watched every show. It had been a bit of a roller coaster for the cast. They had only, it's the National Youth Music Theatre, so the cast members are between the ages of 16 and 23. And for those of you who don't already know, the show is set in the First World War, and it's about the events leading up to the first day of the Battle of the Somme for a group of Leeds-based brass players, brass musicians who go over to fight, and they're women folk who are all working at the Barnbow Munitions Factory, making the shell cases, the shells to send over to France to fight against the enemy, have decided to reform the men's brass bands and learn to play the instruments so that they can welcome their menfolk triumphantly home from the front. But of course, history tells us that that never happened, and the men never came home. It is a fictitious story. It's all based on historical facts, but that itself never happened. That's aside, most people who watch the show are convinced that it was actually true, which is brilliant, because the story is so touching. It's beautiful. Anyway, they'd only had... it was done by NYMT, as I say, and it was commissioned by Ben 2 years ago in 2014 to commemorate the centenary of the start of the First World War, but this year is the centenary of the first day of the Battle of the Somme, which was July the 1st, 1916. So that's why they remounted it this year. And oh my goodness, I'm so glad they did. When it was done before in Leeds, it was a tiny, tiny little theatre, and not very many people got a chance to see it. Partly because of the size of the theatre, but partly because it was in Leeds, which is a long way from London, and so reviewers and critics couldn't really make it up there. This time, however, the response was just amazing. Now, I'm used to being in theatres where people go crazy for stuff. It's lovely. When you really can reach an audience, when you can touch an audience and affect an audience, it's a really powerful thing. And I genuinely have never witnessed anything quite like it. The show is very, very emotional. The music is big, epic, and sweeping. You can actually buy the soundtrack. The original cast recorded the show last year, and that's available on iTunes. It's Brass by the National Youth Music Theatre, Benjamin Till. Or you can purchase it from Ben's website. Address right here, benjamintill.com/shop. And he'll send that out to you if you... actually, no, that's not true. That's entirely wrong. You can't buy it from Ben's website. You can buy something else from Ben's website, which I'm going to talk about in a minute, but you can buy the Brass soundtrack from the NYMT website, which is here. So the music is epic and sweeping and highly emotionally charged. And we had people weeping openly and snuffling and sniffling all the way through the second half. But at the end of the show, on the Friday night, the audience leapt to their feet. There was none of that, you know, the orchestra plays, starts its play out and the band, the cast come on and start bowing and people go, one or two people will stand up and then someone will go, oh, go on then, we'll stand up. And gradually people stand up. And then towards the end, most people are standing up just because they can't see over the people standing in front of them. That really wasn't the case. I've never seen anything like it. The audience, as one, leapt to their feet. And I just turned around and looked up at the circle behind us because we were in the stalls. So the mezzanine, because we were in the orchestra for my American cousins. And I said to Ben, look. And even the whole circle were up on their feet, banging their hands together, clapping and cheering. It's amazing. It's really, really amazing. Then the play out started, and Ben has written this really, really great piece of orchestral music. It was a medley of songs from the show just to send the audience out. Usually, of course, an audience files out during the play out, and if there are a few people left at the end, you get a little smattering of applause. Sounds like someone put the chips in the Jeep Fat Fryer. Just to say thank you to the band, and off they go. Nothing like that. The audience did not want this to end. And I said to Ben, look down at the front. And there are probably 100-odd people all around the rail at the orchestra pit, all hanging over, looking down and enjoying the music, and people were dancing and jigging around. It seems I'd forgotten to delete some large files from my phone and I ran out of space, but here I'm back. So anyway, where was I? People just did not want the show to end and they were really, really enjoying the play out. Now this happened again on the Saturday afternoon, and even more people were clamouring around the orchestra pit and having a wonderful time. And then, oh goodness, this was so gratifying for Ben, I was so proud of him. In the evening, the audience had gone utterly mental at the end of the show. All the way through the show, every time one of the big numbers finished, people were whooping and cheering and screaming. Some of the songs and the dances in the show are so energetic and so vibrant, they just get right inside you. And people wanted to respond physically, and so cheering was how it manifested itself. Not just polite applause, but actual big old cheers. And that grew as the show went on. People became more and more engaged, and the cheering swelled at the end of each one. It was bigger than the last number, and bigger and bigger. At the end of the show, again, everyone on their feet, screaming and having an amazing time. The cast came onto it, the bows went off, the band struck up the play out. Oh, it was just amazing. Ben and I this time rushed down to the front because we wanted to be part of that atmosphere, knowing that people were probably going to be looking at the band and watching it. And there were 18 members of the orchestra. It was a big, big band. And it was just so lovely to have a band that size just enjoying playing. They were loving playing the music and enjoying playing such great music. So I then said to Ben has very sort of focused vision. He doesn't necessarily see the whole picture, he just sees what he's focused on. So I often have to steer him a little bit. I said, Ben, look up at the circle. Not only was everybody in the whole stalls there, ready to enjoy the music, up in the circle, nobody had left. Everyone had moved to the front and they were all standing and they were dancing and clapping and cheering and screaming. And I immediately got my phone out. I'm going to play you a little bit of a video in a moment because I think it's an atmosphere like I've never seen in a theatre before. So I was filming it. The camera works dreadful because I was trying to capture everything. So the auditorium and in the band. And then the ovation as the band finished was so huge. And it was one of those things that built and built and built. And then people started shouting for more and encore, and eventually the band had to strike up again and they played part of the play out a second time. It was magical. It was absolutely magical. And I loved every second of it. The show has had the most incredible reviews. Let me see if I can give you a few choice quotes. There's a gentleman called Mark Shenton, who, if you are in the know in musical theatre, you'll know that he's probably our most influential musical theatre critic. And he tweeted after the show, he loved the show, he tweeted afterwards, "It was a magnificent miracle of a show. People should run, not walk, to get a ticket for the next two performances he saw on the Friday night. And it should transfer to the National Theatre." Well, wouldn't that be nice? And then there's a theatre review here that says, "The show's lead creative, Benjamin Till, is responsible for the holy trinity of book, lyrics and music, and his writing is monumental, an audacious combination of Oh, What a Lovely War and Les Mis. Every song hits the mark and is perfectly placed, the ebb and flow of the numbers ensuring a rollercoaster of a ride, from the triumphant and celebratory to the heart-wrenching and devastating. Each number is absolutely compelling, and Till deserves to be seated at musical theatre's top table for his efforts. Brass is truly an epic musical event. I can't think of a better British score from recent years, and it has just added itself to my list of top five shows of 2016. The 40th anniversary season of NYMT is an encouraging sign that the West End and beyond will not be short of talent in the coming years." I mean, Ben couldn't have bought a better review. His mum couldn't have written I couldn't have written a better review than that. I'll stop wishing on about it. It was truly, truly amazing, and the young people had such an amazing time. People who have followers of this podcast will remember that I went to France with the cast a couple of months ago, at the end of June, to take the cast to the spot where the men went over the top and the people that they were playing fought and died. It was really, really powerful, and I think a lot of them took that experience with them into the show. We had just the most amazing time. It's quite all-consuming. Life kind of stops when something like that's going on. They were only rehearsing for 2 weeks. It's not long. It's a big, long show with a lot of music and a lot of things to learn. And so Ben was away down in Sevenoaks for most of the first of those 2 weeks, and then they were rehearsing in London at the theatre for the second week. Just brilliant. Just brilliant. Life, when musical theatre is really good, Katie, you know what I'm talking about, and I'm sure many others do as well, but when musical theatre is really good, there's just nothing better. For me, there is no art form that can sublimate life's experience in such a way that is fulfilling and thrilling and involving and affecting more than musical theatre. It's just, for me, it's the complete package, and that's why I've devoted my life to it, and that's why I'm so proud when I can be a small part of, because yes, it's true, Ben wrote book, music and lyrics on Brass, but I'm credited as additional material, and I'm very, very proud of that. Additional material by Nathan Taylor and Sir Arnold Wesker, it says. Of course, Arnold sadly passed away earlier this year, so we never got to see the show for its London premiere. I know he'd have been very proud, as am I. That's kind of it, really. There's not been a great deal else going on in my life. I have been knitting various bits and pieces. I want to show you some of that. Some of the stuff that I want to show you I don't have anymore, so I can show you a few pictures. I hope that's going to be okay. A lot of the whips that you are used to seeing haven't necessarily progressed a great deal further, but let's crack on. I'm very pleased that I've got some community stuff to share, and the first thing I want to talk about are the there's a few questions in my podcast questions thread. If you're not a member of the Ravelry group already, please go along and join up. We're a nice bunch of people there, and there's always a nice little bit of banter going on. And I have a podcast questions thread specifically for people who want to know anything at all about me, or about anything really. If I don't know the answer, maybe I'll look it up. But please do pop your questions in there. I have one which was sent a little while ago from Pakasha. I don't know if that's your... I don't know how if that's how to say the name. Let me see. Your first name seems to be Pakasha, and you're located in New Mexico. maybe it's not your name, maybe it's just your handle. Either way, you posted and said, "Hello Nathan, I was wondering what your favourite Hedwig and the Angry Inch song was. It is my favourite musical of all time, as well it should be, and I squealed when I discovered you played Hedwig. I live not far from where John Cameron Mitchell is from, and I'm living in the same small New Mexican town Neil Patrick Harris is from." Neil Patrick Harris, of course, who recently played Hedwig on Broadway. "So I feel in many connections to the musical. Plus, the movie was recommended to me at a pivotal time in my life. Gah, so much love for it. That's it, thank you." Well, for those of you who don't know and have never heard of Hedwig and the Angry Inch, it's a really, really powerful piece of musical theatre, and it started off a little off-Broadway theatre in New York called the Jane Street Theatre, and John Cameron Mitchell is the writer. He starred in it originally, but then other people took over, and then the show came over to London for the West End production, and I was lucky enough to be in the cast for that. It is a one-woman show. Hedwig is a she's a an East German transsexual rock chick who tells her story through narrated monologue. She sort of takes on, adopts all of the different characters that affect her in her life, and it's just her and the band on stage. It's a 90-minute monologue with just her, and I was lucky enough and fortunate enough to be the alternate Hedwig, which meant that I played the show every Monday. It's a very, very tiring and stamina needing show, and Michael Cerveris, who recently got the Tony for Fun Home on Broadway, he was playing Hedwig at the time, and he's amazing. I learned a lot from watching him in the show, and I was his alternate, so I would have been his understudy as well. If he'd ever gone off sick, I would have filled in for him, but my job was to be there to give him Mondays off so that he could have a longer weekend and recover for the next week. And it is one of my two favourite jobs ever. I think Rocky Horror Show and Hedwig are the best. I played Frankenfurter in the Rocky Horror Show and Hedwig in Hedwig and the Angry Inch. And I'm still very proud to say, I may have said this before, but I'm still the only English person ever to play the role of Hedwig in the West End. Marvellous. And it's a big, big job. So gosh, I don't know how to answer that question. So many of the songs in that show mean so much to me. I didn't come to the show in the way a lot of its fans did, as in like you finding that it spoke to you at a pivotal point in your life. And I think a lot of people do, and a lot of people have real associations with it because of that. I came to it from, I had seen the show, I'd seen it in New York before I auditioned for it here, so I knew what I was getting myself into, and I'd loved it. I wasn't quite sure what to make of it, but I knew I'd just witnessed something miraculous and amazing. I saw it at the Jane Street Theatre long before the Neil Patrick Harris run on Broadway recently. And gosh, because of what the show signified for me in terms of my career and being in the West End and playing such an extraordinary role, and gosh, I had to relearn everything about myself to play that role as a performer, because my voice has always been sort of very kind of classic musical theatre, and the music in Hedwig and the Angry Inch is rock and heavy rock and punk, and I had to really relearn how to sing and how to learn how to sing and make those noises. The musical director would run into my dressing room with me while we were still rehearsing at the theatre, because obviously Michael was busy doing his thing on stage, so we'd have some spare time, and he'd just come into my dressing room with his guitar, and we'd sit around and say, "Okay, just let's go through the songs." He'd go, no, just stop singing so much, just dirty that note up, just cut, fall off it, don't hit that note, just come under it. And it was like, oh my god, all my life I'd spent my entire time trying to be the most perfect singer and be bang in tune and really sort of hit things with spin and resonance and all the rest. It was like, no, nasal, key, all the things that were the opposite of everything I had been learning all my life as a singer, I had to then start. It was really liberating, difficult, hard to let that stuff go, but really, really liberating, and right as well, right for that kind of music. So it was a big deal for me, and so as a result, pretty much every song in the show has a very special resonance for me. I would have to say, If I could give you my top three, and they're probably in this reverse order, with number one being last. At number three, I would say The Wicked Little Town. It's a gentle moment of reflection for Hedwig in the show, and it's a bit of a breather for the actor playing Hedwig. But it's a very, very intimate moment. It's a very vulnerable moment, and it allows Hedwig to be vulnerable without the rage and the anger that taints so much of the rest of her personality. And for me, that was very special. I've sung that song a couple of times in cabaret since. In fact, the first time I sang it in cabaret, was really emotional for me. It was about 15 years since I had sung that song, and it all just brought, it's brought all the Hedwig memories come flooding back. In number two, I would probably say Midnight Radio, the finale song, just because it's so epic and it's so uplifting and sad at the same time, and so huge to sing. And because of where Hedwig was at the end of the show, where I was physically and emotionally at the end of the show, it's such a kind of a relief to get to that point. And Hedwig is drained, and the whole story has unfolded, and she's left as she. Oh, it's just. I'm sorry for anyone who doesn't know the show, and I'm making no sense to you at all. But if you don't know the show, go and see it. And if you can't go and see it live, go and see the film, because both are brilliant, and you'll get an understanding of what I'm talking about. But I think the song that would be number one for me would be The Origin of Love. I suspect that's a bit of a cliched answer. I just really loved the story that it tells. For anyone who doesn't know, it's the story of Plato's Symposium, the fact that there used to be three types of people, one group that looked like two men glued up back to back. One that looked like two women joined together, and one that looked like a man and a woman joined together. And because they displeased the gods, Zeus sent down thunderbolts at them and split the groups of people apart and scattered them across the world. And that we are left in our lives constantly trying to seek out our other half, the person who completes us, the person who makes us feel whole. Gosh, that's a big, big thing to be talking about. It's a big, big thing to be singing about, and it's a beautiful song. And I used to really look forward to singing Origin of Love every night, and I loved it. I enjoyed it so much, and I think for me that would be it. So thank you, Pakasha, or Pakasha, Pakasha. Thank you for your question. That brings back a lot of very, very lovely memories for me. Next up in the question field. Oh, it's John. Hello, John. Beardy Cheel on Ravelry here, podcaster extraordinaire from Scotland. He says here, several years ago, I was fortunate to be cast in Lenny in Of Mice and Men. Never in all my 40 years of amateur productions did I feel as stretched by a role or as challenged to play it with compassion, understanding, and a desire to respectfully portray someone whose personal barriers to society and its norms are impossible to overcome. The emotional impact that role had on me is still palpable and lives with me every day. So my question to you as a professional is, what has been your most emotionally invested role? Well, John, I've just covered it. Absolutely, 100% Hedwig. Frankenfurter, big, big deal for me as well, and I thoroughly enjoyed playing that. That's more of a romp. It's exhausting, and it's difficult vocally, and it's lots of power and adrenaline and lots of responsibility to carry the show. But I think emotionally, most definitely Hedwig. To play, I didn't. By when I played Hedwig, I hadn't. Hadn't met ever met any transsexual people or transgender people. I don't like the term transsexual very much. Transgender fits much better for me, because gender and sexuality are two very different things. Gender is who you are. Sexuality is what you're attracted to, and the two are not necessarily linked in any way. So I think somebody who has transitioned from one gender to the other is therefore transgender. So I don't know. Hedwig was always billed as a transsexual rock chick. That was kind of always, maybe that was the words that were just in common parlance then, and maybe we've got a shift towards transgender now, or just plain trans. I didn't know any trans people back then. I know several now, and I count some of them among my very good friends. And in fact, one of the cast of Brass is a trans actor, young Harrison, who is now 20, I think. And the joy of him being in Brass is he's on stage for the first time ever as a man, which is brilliant, absolutely brilliant. In fact, The Guardian, the newspaper over here, did an article on him about his time performing in Brass, and they sort of wanted to, I think they wanted to make out that it was a thing, that he was, for some reason, that he'd been cast in the show as a bit of a box-ticking exercise. And they asked the director about this in the interview, and they said, you know, was it just useful to have him in the show because of the significance of having a trans actor? She went, no, she said, when he auditioned, I didn't know. He wasn't playing a trans role, he was just one of the ensembles, one of the lads. And he's very much out and proud as a trans member of society, which is very, very different from how things would have been for Hedvig. It would have been about trying to hide that and trying to pass as cisgendered. And it's also because I was playing that in 2000, 2001, so trans awareness has become a lot greater now. Transphobia is still a big thing, don't get me wrong, we've got a long way to go. I think just getting inside the head, or trying to get inside the head, was very difficult for me at that time. Inside the head of somebody whose experiences were so far removed from my own. I was a gay man, but I had not been, am not, don't think I ever will be a trans man or a trans woman, as I would be if I went the other way. So it was hard, and I did some research. And I tried to read up as much as I could on what it was like to go through the psychology of being born in a body that you don't feel fits who you are as a person. And it was tough, really tough. The script did a lot of the work for me. It's a very well-written script. And you understand her turmoil, and you understand why she's perhaps very angry and embittered towards a lot of aspects of the world. But yeah, the emotional investment in that, to create the role in a way that was convincing, very much marks Hedvig out as the answer to your question. And finally, from... there's two, one only a couple of hours ago. From T and Stitches, who's Michelle from Australia. Hi from Australia, I love listening to your voice and knowledge. Well, thank you very much. Sorry if this has been asked, but I wanted to know what needles you use and why you chose them. Hoping to cast on my socks next. Marvellous, well, good news. I think I have talked about this before, but I may as well touch on it again. The needles I most often use, in fact, almost always, are Chow Gu interchangeables. I've got a set of the Twist. It's called Chow Gu Twist is the set, and it's got 13 sets of needle tips ranging from 2.75 up to 10 mil, I think. And they come in a range of sizes with these wonderful cable, the red cables, which are metal in there, but they're almost entirely kink-free. I don't want to like squash it and test it, but they don't kink. They're just wonderful. They're nice and mobile, and they don't boing out. And I love a metal tip. I like slick, fast knitting, and they've got nice finely tapered points on them, which make for very, very good work. I like a fast set of needles. So that's that. Quick and easy. Nice dirty answer. Now this is one for Smine, whose name I don't know. I think I've asked you before and I can't remember, and it's not on your Ravelry profile. I'm so sorry. But Smine is a designer and she's brilliant, and she's such a accurate knitter. Her tension is always so beautiful, and her work is so gorgeous. It looks like it's been done by a machine. Beautiful work. But she said, my question is, what can be done about the tension differences between front and back side of double knitting when knitting in the round? I'm currently making a hat, which is my first piece of double knitting and my own design, and it's working out fine, except that my negative side is slightly looser than my front side, so the inner fabric has more volume. I suppose I could work my hats inside out to minimise the problem in future. Yes, you can. But what about if it were a cowl, and being double knitting, potentially the hat where I might want to flip the hat the other way round? So I would like to learn how to fix it if possible. How can I combat the tension differences? I've tried being aware of it and tried manually pulling my pearl stitches much tighter, but that hasn't made a difference, and will give you RSI as well. I don't, you don't want to be doing anything that causes tension in your knitting. When I'm single knitting, there's no tension differences, so this is puzzling me. Any advice or tips appreciated? Well, there's, do you know what? The quest for even tension between the two sides is possibly a lifelong one, and I don't want to put you off. There are things you can do. You've already talked about knitting the hat inside out. You could, but then that would lead it, the other one, to be a bit looser if it's something to do with the way you're creating your stitches. I have the same problem. It doesn't worry me too much. You have posted pictures on, and I can see what you mean. Although your tension is so beautifully even, I would probably not worry about it if it were me. But I genuinely understand the need to strive for perfection. I get it. One of the things that I would suggest is if you're working double knitting in the round, you might want to look into changing how you create your purl stitches. Usually a purl stitch takes up more yarn than a knit stitch. Often that can lead to looser stitches, looser purl stitches than knit stitches. It's just something that's how people row out. You know this, but for other people who don't. And that can be down to a lot of different factors. The way a knit stitch is created, there's just less yarn that goes into it than when you're making a purl stitch. However, you might want to look at the alternate purl for when you're doing double knitting in the round, meaning that instead of wrapping your yarn anti-clockwise around the needle tip, you wrap the other way, and it brings the previous stitch closer to the strand of yarn that you're about to pull through, closer to the working area than if you're going round the long way, and can use up less yarn. And a lot of people find that that works well for them and creates really nice even tension between their knits and their purls in double knitting. I'm not surprised to hear you say that there's no difference in your single face knitting, and I think that's partly to do with the fact that when double knitting, of course, there's space between the stitches, because each single face knitting, your stitches on the needle like that. Double knitting, you've got these ones for the other side pushing them apart, so there's going to be more space, so you have slightly less control over how much yarn is wrapped around the needle, because they're pushed apart. That is probably also a contributing factor for you. So if you therefore go to doing the purls with the yarn going wrapping the other way, it's more of a mirror image of what the knits and the purls are to each other. It will of course mean that when you come back to knitting those purl stitches, they will be mounted the opposite way. So instead of having the right leg in front, they'll have the left leg in front. So you need to work into them, purl into them through the back loop. That might be a step too far. I have always thought that I don't particularly want to change the way I knit. So I'm quite happy with a baggy backside, if you'll pardon. I didn't mean that as it came out. As I heard the words in my head, I thought, no, I'm going to say it anyway. I don't mind a baggy backside. Oopsie. Right, let's move straight on. into community. Let's go into community from that. Never let it be said that I would discriminate against anybody for having a baggy backside. So, in community, right, there's a couple of things I want to talk about here, and well, one really. Now, I was contacted by a very lovely lady called Maggie, who lives in Tennessee, I believe. You're in Maggie. Knit by Maggie is your Ravelry profile. There, and some of the things that you said to me prompted me to think, and it was echoed. Actually, I'd already been having this thought, and then Leslie, hello Leslie, who's Porthia, had come up with the same sort of plan, and I think that I want to share with you, Maggie, if you don't mind. I would like to share with you joint ownership of a knit along via this podcast. And the reason I want to do it with you, Maggie, is because I think looking, I've looked at your projects, I've been a bit stalkerish, and I know that you've got quite a lot of stranded work on your projects pages. And it's all great stuff, really, really nice stuff. And I would like, do you know what, I'm just going to change the resolution of this because it's a little bit bright. That's a little bit better, isn't it? I would like to, it's a bit too dark perhaps, I do this all the time. There you go, there's your halfway house. There we go. How about that? Is that better? I think so. So I want to, because this is my year of trying to perfect stranded knitting, and I haven't really done enough of it because I've been sidetracked with other things, I thought perhaps it would be really nice to start a stranded Maggie along, and you and I can both sort of moderate and share people's finished objects and chat to people and stuff like that. I think it'll be a really good way of getting people engaging together with stranded work. And this is all thanks to what you had said to me and what I saw from your project pages. So with that in mind, I want to, I'm not going to start it just yet. So this is just sort of something that I'm thinking through. So Maggie, if you don't mind, let's get in touch and let's talk about how we can make this work. I'd like to base it around one pattern, but I'm not going to expect people to knit that pattern. The pattern I want to sort of use as the foundation for it is my stranded cowl, which has been folded up and has got a bit of a crease in it. Didn't notice that. So this stranded cowl here, which I haven't yet released the pattern for, but it will encourage me to get it sorted. And that's what I really want to do. So I want to get that written up and there we go. So I want to get this written up and released so that we can do a nice little, hi. We can do a nice little cowl for it. And I would obviously do a hefty discount for anybody who's making it for the cowl, and perhaps prizes of refunding the money for the finished objects of the winners and all that kind of stuff, so that it will encourage people to want to make it. It's a really, you know, come on, who wouldn't want a cowl that looks like this, really? I mean, it's, look at that pan. I'm not taking credit for it, I'm not being arrogant. I ripped this off from a 16th century Italian. But it is lovely. I really like that design. So it'll encourage me to get this out of bed. It's really warm. It's beautiful to wear, but really, really warm. So I'm not going to wrap it around me. Maybe I'll just wear it there like a toga of some kind, so you can have it in shop while we're talking about it. However, excuse me, to say that I would need everybody to enter the cowl knitting this, not true. I think anything that's a stranded project, stranded Fair Isle, there is a distinction, I'm not going to limit it to Fair Isle. This would count as Fair Isle, I guess, because it goes all the way around the pattern, it's only two colours per row. But it's not traditional Fair Isle design. But Fair Isle or stranded, anything that uses two colours in the same row, or more, let's go Latvian if we want to. And I think we should maybe have that running through October, so that we can make some really nice projects for that. So Maggie, if you're up for that, let me know, and then we can coordinate that together. I'd be really interested in sharing that with you if you're keen on the idea. Even putting it over my shoulder, it's too hot. I can't do it. It's too warm today. Too warm. There we go. Right, anyway, so that's that, Maggie. So let's get in touch. Let's make that happen. Marvellous. I think I should probably combine the next section of what I want to talk about community-wise with a segue into stash enhancement. And the reason for that will become very clear. I was approached a few months ago by, it's gone completely out of my head, our researchers, and put it here. Thank you very much for doing it. For someone who was hosting the Christmas in July podcasters knit along swap. And it was about hooking up podcasters with other podcasters, people you might not know, and making a little swap out of it. And the original idea, which we didn't really stick to, but the original idea was that we would knit a handmade Christmas ornament for each other, and then put in some mini skeins and some and a card and some nice stuff. But basically, nice stuff. And I was paired up with Shannon Fisher from the Socks Etc. Socks, I said earlier. I think that's how. I always get this wrong. Shannon, I can never remember. Is it socks, etc. or socks, etc.? Socks, etc.? I'm going to have to find out because it's going to bug me so, so much. Let's have a little look on my YouTube channel and I will find out for sure. I don't know if I can do it in post, but I want to. Sockcetera. Sockcetera. Right there. Sockcetera. And I didn't know Shannon's podcast at the time. I'd never come across her before, and I'm so glad I have. I really enjoy watching her. I've got a few to catch up on. I'm still not fully up to date, and I went back to start at the beginning, so I'm playing catch up still. And we had some really nice communication with each other, and we Shannon. Thank you, Shannon. She started the ball rolling. She said, do you know what? Because we're supposed to, I think you're supposed to do it by the end of, just post it by the end of June or something like that. And she went, no, it's not going to happen. I will get it to you by the end of July. She's like, okay, yeah, well, I haven't started mine either. That's brilliant. Let's give each other the benefit of the doubt. Lovely bit of breathing space and it'll be absolutely fine. End of July came. Neither of us finished what we were supposed to be doing. So finally, I think we both got our passes off to each other at about the same time. We both now have received our parcels and I love what's in mine and I'm going to share it with you now. I had put in, into Shannon's, I had put some chocolate, 100% cocoa solids, 100%. Dark, bitter chocolate. Two mini skeins, which I had, let's see if I can find the picture of the stuff. Two mini skeins that I'd wound myself from two of my favourite skeins of yarn of things that I've used recently. Where did it go? It was before my trip, so I need to scroll back a little bit further. Not quite that far. Oh, goodness, don't you hate it when podcasters do this? I should have planned this much, much better. Here they are. These are the two skeins. The navy and purple and turquoise down the bottom there is some Volmizer Pure that I'd made a lacy stole for my mother out of. And the top rainbow-coloured one is the Misty Alpaca Eat Peace Love Sock. I love it, just love it, absolutely love it. And so I've given her those, and I've knitted a little Christmas tree, a little square with a little Christmas tree design on, double knitting, of course, for her Christmas decoration, and put in a card and all the nice things. And in return, I got, not gonna lie, Shannon, a delightfully eccentric and random set of objects, which I have thoroughly enjoyed. I don't know. This is Reuben washi tape from Scotch. It's lovely. It's black and white stripes. I'm very, very glad to own it. Thank you, Shannon. I also received this notebook, exceptional web content, and all the pages are little hexagons, so great for doodling and making notes and stuff. Very handy, very attractive little book. I like that. I haven't read all of this yet. I'm about halfway through. This is called Rules of the Red Rubber Ball, and it says on it that it's an adult's version of Dr. Seuss's Oh, the Places You'll Go, a pocket-sized guide to finding your way in life. So it's very sort of life-affirming, self-affirming, self-help kind of thing. But it's done in a really nice way, and it's got lots of the way it's been put together. All the text is it's not written like ordinary text in a book. I'm enjoying dipping into that every now and then. I'm about halfway through. Then, now, some of you who, if you don't follow Shannon's Instagram, she posts some lovely pictures, but she's also learning sort of watercolour artistry. Now, I This is going to make sense if I try and find this picture on my Instagram feed. I had Instagrammed something a little while ago, which was me. Where is it? Me and I'd stuck loads of DPNs in my beard. Stop it. Back to search Instagram. And I said something stupid like, oh, that's where my things went to. Now I just need to find it. Where's my section of, where's my actual picture? It's gonna go back some time, I think. Oh, here it is. So this is the picture that I had posted of myself, just with a baby beard at the time. And I just posted it with the, now if I could only find where I put my DPNs, hashtag human kaplunk. So that was that. And Shannon Instagrammed a few days later. Look at that. Isn't this the most narcissistic shot any podcaster has ever put on screen? The real me, the previous me, and the arty me. I think it's a really good likeness. I absolutely love it. Captured everything on there. It's great. And so I've got the original, which I treasure and will treasure for a very, very long time to come. And then she sent me a lovely, lovely card with this gorgeous picture on the front of Shannon herself and her oh-so-very handsome husband. And it says, I'm not going to read it, it's just between me and Shannon. But it was lovely, lovely stuff. However, all of that came with a very lovely project bag which she had made herself. And she says, part of the card I will read out, says, I hope this project bag suits you. I'm of the mind that colours are for everyone, but I know that's not everyone's style. Well, this is me. I love coloured stuff. And this is gorgeous. This sort of turquoisey teal with this wonderful lines pattern and the navy, I think, go very well together. And the inside is this gorgeous, vibrant mustard gold. And a big chunky zip, which I really like. And it's got the sock. See, I could have just looked at that, couldn't I? Sockcetera logo on there. It's really, it's quite stiff fabric, which is nice. It feels really durable and manly. Manly bags. Love it. Love it. So there's something in it already, which I'm going to show you later on. So this kind of goes into stash enhancement. That was my segue, you see? So Shannon, thank you so much. And to anyone who hasn't started watching Sockcetera or subscribing to her, please do head over there and give her some podcast love. She's great fun. And Shannon, it's been lovely getting to know you, and I hope we stay friends. And if you are ever in London, please, please look me up and we'll go for a hot chocolate. And if you need a place to stay, we don't have a lot of room, and you may find that you would rather stay somewhere else, but you'd be very welcome to stay with us here. And that's a genuine offer. So let's move straight on then, in that case, to stash enhancement, which in fairness is only that. I'm just trying to think, there isn't anything else. I have, in fact, bought some yarn. Well, I've ordered some yarn. It hasn't arrived yet. I ordered it probably only yesterday afternoon. There's no way it was going to get here. And I've ordered, it's the Drops Andes, a sweater's quantity of their super bulky weight yarn. Drops Andes in a lovely sort of heathered dark grey. And there's a very good reason for that. I have ordered it because I am planning to make Twilight Zone by what is Dario's full name? Dario Tubian? Oh gosh, I can't. Let's get rid of that one. Tubiana. Dario Tubiana. You're Italian. And do you know what? I'm assuming you don't watch the podcast. You've probably got no idea who I am. But if ever you do watch this, I absolutely love the Twilight Zone jumper that you have designed. It's a simple, basic, chunky jumper for a man to wear. And there's something about it. I absolutely love it. And here it is. It's roll neck jumper. It looks so cozy and so fantastic. And I love the detailing on the around the collar in the contrast colour. I absolutely love it. And it's current. He's a Rosso Cardinale, which you can probably just see on the top of the screen there. Rosso Cardinale. I don't know why I said that. I've put it here on Ravelry. And you know, Dario, you are a pretty good designer, even though it doesn't look like you've been doing it very long. So you've only got two, there's only two projects, two designs on there, both fabulous jumpers. And this one is available as a free download. So I follow Dario on Instagram, and he's Rosso Cardinale on there as well, and had fallen in love with watching this jumper take shape and the progress of it. It's like, I don't make garments. I really don't. I really want to make that. I really, really want it. So I bought the Drop Sandys yarn. It's so cheap. It's £3.90 for 100 grams. And it's half wool, half alpaca. I don't know how they do it. So for a sweater quantity, and the pattern calls for a 100 gram lots of that, a kilogram of yarn, it's only £39. I think that's like really, really good quality, really good value for a big chunky jumper, which you pay probably a lot more for that in the shops. It's one of the few times when knitting is cheaper than buying commercially made products, I think. So love it, love, love, love it. I will show you more about that yarn next time, because hopefully by then it will have arrived, and maybe I'll cast it on. No, I mustn't cast it on. I am struggling a bit at the moment with having too many whips. Too many whips for me. I know I'm a rank outsider when it comes to the total of whips that some people have. I know people have got things on every pair of needles they own. And I never thought that would be a problem. I thought, that's okay, well, it's just things. But actually, I don't like it. I like to have about three things on the go at once. I've got five or six at the moment, and I don't feel I can give any of them the love and attention that they need. There's things I want to be knitting and working on, but I feel when I'm working on them that I should be doing something else and knitting something different, and that's not relaxing, that's not comforting at all. So, let's move on into finished objects, first of all, because I do have some finished objects to talk about. At last. You may remember I had been knitting some plain vanilla socks with the Sockmatician's toe-ups recipe in Zena's blue Hawaii colourway hand-dyed sock yarn on the Soprano sock base. Well, they're done. It's colourways are going to blow out the phone. I really like them. Very, very happy with these. I think the colours are gorgeous. If you can see quite close up, there's quite some strong heathering there. There's a real depth. Some of the yarn has hardly taken any of the blue at all, and some of it's taken quite a lot, particularly things like there's a dark blue patch there, which I think is lovely. Really, really nice. Gives a lot of depth to it. And they're just, well, why don't I model one of them? Why don't I pop it on for the world to see? Sockmatician's toe-ups are still, for me, one of the best fitting patterns. That's why I wrote it, of course. It works very, very nicely for me. And this sock is quite a long sock. As you can see, it comes midway up my shin. The other one does as well, and I've still got that much left. I'm a size 9 foot, English size 9, and this is, I've got my scales here. Let me show you how much I've got left. It was a 100 gram skein, and I'm just putting it on the scales now, and I've still got 21 grams left. So these socks only used 80 grams of yarn. There's two of them, they're big, I've got large feet, and they're long. So I think that's incredibly good value. I knit them on, why don't I put the other one on? It seems a bit silly not to. I knit them on Chowgu lace pointed needles on 2mm, and I used a base number. And if you're familiar with the Sockmatician's toe-up recipe, you'll know that it all hangs from the base number. My base number is 72, and yeah, they're really, really, really nice. Hello. I'm very, very happy with them. I like my socks to have quite a lot of negative ease, so they are quite snug, and some people like it with less, but you can adapt the pattern to suit yourself as you so wish. So they're really kind of fun. They're just a standard heel flap and gusset sock for anyone who's not familiar with the Sockmatician's toe-ups, as if. I've been banging on about them for months now. And they... their toe-ups, obviously, and you work them till you get to the gusset. You work a gusset, you work a heel turn using German short rows, which makes for a very, very nice, neat and tidy heel turn. You can see there with absolutely no holes or problems or issues. Then it's got a slip stitch heel for extra wear, as all good socks should, and then you work up straight leg into a cuff with a nice stretchy bind off. Very nice indeed. So thank you, Zena, for the beautiful dye lot that you created. I thoroughly enjoyed being able to buy some of those from you. And I shall now wear my blue Hawaii toe-ups with pride. The other FOs that I have got to show you, I can only show you photographs, and that pains me. While Ben was in rehearsals for Brass, he was down in Sevenoaks rehearsing at Sevenoaks School there, and I was at home, and I popped down to see them in Sevenoaks one afternoon, and he'd got quite a lot of the cast knitting, and that was brilliant, because knitting is mentioned in the show, because of course, throw the old socks out of the way, because of course knitting was a big part of the war effort. Knitting socks and gloves and mittens and things for the boys at the front was something that the women folk could do and feel that they were contributing, and they were useful things to have. Of course, when you're in the trenches and you're freezing cold, it's nice to have some handmade woolly knits. So this is referenced in the show, and there's some comedy value because some of the women are not good knitters, but they're doing their best. And in the show, there's a couple of lines that this girl is knitting for the man that she fancies, who doesn't incidentally fancy her back, but she's knitting a pair of mittens for him, and she's supposed to hold up one mitten that she's made, and then the other one on the needles, which is a completely different size. And the joke is, oh, are you using different needles? And she says, oh, my friend sat on the others, and the comedy value is not in the lines, the comedy value is in the visuals. Now, it was a few days before the show was due to open. No, it wasn't. Well, yeah, I'd gone down to Sevenoaks, that's right, I'd gone down to Sevenoaks and I'd seen that they were all knitting little garter stitch squares and scarves and things. And I said, well, who's making the mittens? And it seems that the stage management crew had said to the girl who says the lines, can you knit the mittens? She's like, yes. This girl had never knitted anything before in her life and could barely manage a garter stitch scarf. But because she's young and she's only 16 and she didn't want to look like she was being difficult, she said yes. So of course stage manager thought, well, great, she's going to do it. So I said to Ben, well, what are the mittens like? And they were basically just a square, like a rectangle, two squares next to each other that had been folded around with like hand. I was like, no. I said, that's just not... Unless it's on the hand with fingers coming out through the holes at the top, I said, it's just not going to look like a mitten. He said, well, there's nothing else we can do. I said, the show opens tomorrow. And I was at work. So I said, okay, leave it with me. I'll go out on my lunch break. And I went to John Lewis and I found some big red chunky yarn, massive. And I got some 10mm needles. Didn't have anything with me. I've got 10mm needles at home, but I needed to be knitting them that afternoon while I was still at work, otherwise I wouldn't have time. And I said, I can't promise you everything you need. That he said they wanted two little ones and two big ones. because of the mechanics of the stage, some had to be wrapped up in a parcel for later on, which had to be done before the show, so we needed some for her to play with, and then the recipient would have the same mittens, but they would actually be a different pair. So I can't promise you that, but I said, but I can promise you is you'll have something to show with a comedy value. So I, while I was at work that afternoon, I got going. I've never really knitted a mitten before. I kind of made it up as I went along. I looked at a few free patterns on Ravelry that afternoon, and I thought, well, if you're gonna go big, go big. Mel Brooks always used to say, if you're gonna step up to the bell, ring it or don't step up. And I really like that. I've often used that phrase in life. So I thought, for comedy value, the big one has to be massive. So I bought the biggest, chunkiest yarn I could find. It was huge. And I knitted this mitten, and yes, there are holes in it. I deliberately put some holes in it. I crafted them in with yarn overs and knit two together because I scattered around the place because I wanted it to look like she didn't know how to knit. It's huge. And it did get quite a nice response when she held it up. On the other side, I deliberately put in a ladder, which you can see there, and I put that, it's enormous. I put that ladder in using, I put a yarn over, knit two together at the bottom, knitted about five or six rounds, and then at the top, slipped the stitch off and laddered it down, and then just created another stitch out of the top rung of the ladder, so I didn't lose stitch count. So there's the little one, which was, I deliberately made it too small for me. She could actually probably put her hand in it, but it was too small for me because I wanted the juxtaposition to be as big as possible. And, oh, hello. Oh, that suddenly went crazy. Let me find those again. Oh, well, can't find those photographs. Yeah, there it is. There's the ladder close up. So I had a lot of fun knitting those. I managed to knit the big one. I had about 3 hours at work in between phone calls. There wasn't very much else going on. It was quite quiet and I was up there on my own, which was great, so I could just carry on knitting, which I did, and I managed to finish the whole mitten before I went home. When I got home that night, of course Ben was still in the middle of the technical rehearsal, I then had to knit the small one. And I thought, well, I'll just use smaller needles, and I thought, the yarn was so big. But it was very loosely plied, so I ended up getting my drop spindle out and unplying the yarn, as much of it as I could. There were three strands, and I separated all those and had three little balls of yarn. God, it took ages. And I used one of those balls of yarn, the little unplied ones, to make the smaller mitten with. So it's exactly the same fabric and exactly the same colour, which was important, but thankfully it was just too thick to work at any smaller gauge. So that's what I had to do. That took ages, and I went to bed. When Ben came home, I just finished. Look, here's your mittens. He was, oh my goodness, they're fantastic. Just what the doctor ordered. But it turned out, I got a phone call from him the next morning when he was in rehearsal saying, We need that second mitten, otherwise we can't use them. I said, can you do without a second small one? Do you just need a big one for Alf to pick up and get comedy value out at the other end? And he said, yes. I said, okay, I'll see what I can do. So I sat down and I started making the other one. And the reason I'd taken those photographs was just in case, because Ben had already taken the big ones and the big one and the little one into work. And I needed to make them exactly the same. So I had to put the holes and the ladders in the same places. Not that anyone would ever care. I care. I didn't want anyone to go and say, oh, that's a different mitten. The ladder was on the left-hand side of it. Nobody ever would, I'm sure. No one would notice those things, but I wanted to make two that were the same. So I did, and then I finally took them in, and just before the dress rehearsal, I managed to give them to the stage management to wrap up and put in the right places. And they were able to use them in the show, and it got some nice laughs. So that's my other set of whips. Massive mittens. And I thought, yeah, it'll be good practice for when I make my Latvian mittens that I bought in Riga from the kit when I was with Melody. Hello, Melody. Oh, it was funny. Anyway, that's that. So let's crack on into whips, shall we? There's a new whip. There shouldn't be, having said what I just said about having too many whips on the go at once, but now there is. So, before we do that, there is another FO. Now, I'm not going to show it. When I finish this, I'm going to actually sit and film with it because I need to parcel it up and ship it off to Canada. I think I am allowed to say this now. Eric Lutz of Sticks Plus Twine podcast and Devin from what was Tiny Paper Foxes is now Handmade and Woolen podcast, so in collaboration, many of you know this, and they are creating a new magazine for male knitters and for women who knit for male knitters called Rib Magazine. It's very, very exciting. And I'm going to be contributing a design to the first issue, which is really, really special, and I can't wait to get it all sorted. So I've knitted it. It's down here. I've shown you the yarn before. It's the I'm going to show you the back of it because then you're not going to see anything. So look, there's nice. I've shown you this yarn before in the past, and it's the pewter colourway from Casbar from Handmaidens Fine Yarns, and I absolutely love it. And this, what is that? Something stuck to it, I don't know what it is. This yarn is so beautiful. It's so gorgeous and soft. It's got some cashmere in it, you see. And I've knitted a big scarf, can't see it. I'm gonna parcel that up. So it's still top secret, but I'm allowed to let the cat out of the bag that I am putting a design into the magazine. So that is another of my FOs, which I can't talk about now, but I'll keep the footage of it that I'm about to shoot on the back burner, and when the magazine comes out, I'll be able to show it to you in more detail. I hope that's okay. So, whips. Properly into whips now. So, sadly, I haven't had any time to devote to my piano number 3, the black and orange cable knit, double knit scarf, which I love. I love so much, and I really, really want to get back to it. So this is one of the reasons why I've got too many things on the needles. That one at the moment is not getting the love it needs, and I really, really want it to. So, oh no, I haven't got it here. No, because there's genuinely nothing to show on it. I have. I'm going to finish what I've got. I know what it is. I've got 3 large scale projects on the go. Normally I'd have 1 large scale project on the go and a couple of smaller things, but because I've got 3 big ones on the go, my Il Borato scarf, the Piano number 3 scarf, and the Hexahap, they all take up a lot of time and are going to take a long time to finish and complete. That's great, because they're wonderful knits. I'm enjoying knitting every single one of them, but it does mean that I don't get to the end of it. I should just devote my time to one of them. However, I have put a little bit of more time onto the Il Borato scarf. Last time you saw it, I was only up to about here on this section. I've completed that section, and I've also completed the blue and purple section at the top, which looks like that. So here's the scarf in all its glory. It's definitely getting longer. I am absolutely planning to start weaving in the ends, because I don't want to wait till the end, and because there's quite a few, every time I change the colours, obviously there's a few ends to take care of. I should do it as I go along. Every time I change the colours, I should probably just weave them in. But I never have a needle with me, and I'm often out and about when I'm doing it. I don't often do this out and about, I have to say, because it means having my iPad with me with the charts on it, because they don't exist in printed form yet, because they're not finished, so I'm kind of charting as I go. So it means now it's getting a bit longer, it's a little bit more complicated. I tend to just focus on this when I'm at home. But, oh God, I love it! I really, really love it. Every time I get it out of the bag, I just think, this is so beautiful. It's going to look so opulent and so rich and it feels so sturdy. It's quite tight gauge, and it's only fingering weight yarn, but because it's double knit, it's got that extra solidity to it. It's going to be absolutely stunning. If I may say so myself. What I mean is I'm absolutely going to love it. And I really, really do enjoy knitting it. There's not that many pairs of stitches per row, so like 54 or 56 or something like that. So it's 100 odd stitches, but it's not that many pairs. And when I work on it, when I fly through it, it doesn't feel like it's growing slowly. I'm whipping through each pattern. Oh, it's so beautiful, so beautiful. Right, There we are, that's that. This is of course knit with the four colours of travel knitter yarn. And I've got a ball band in here. Yes, I have travel knitter, which looks like that, which is lovely. Larissa, who's Australian but lives in North East London. So that is the Il Barato scarf, and all of those patterns come from the same 16th century Italian as this chap here. In fact, towards the other end of this scarf, this pattern will resurface and become part of it to tie the two things together, which is very, very lovely and much fun. That's that taken care of. There's also, I haven't got any socks on the go. It feels odd because I've just finished these. I usually cast socks on straight away, so I've always got some on the go, but I haven't this time because I've got all the other things going on. The problem is with that, I don't only like to have complicated knitting on the go, I like to have something brainless, hence these, but I didn't want to cast anything else on because I've already got too many things on the go. That said, I did cast something else on. It's just not socks. But before I get to that, now, the Hexahap is coming on. This is Tom van Dalen, Tom of Holland, as he is known. This is his pattern from the wonderful book of Haps from Kate Davis and Jen Arnold Culliford. I always think I get her name wrong. I'm now well into the third. Can you see that? I can't actually see through. Hello. It is going to be enormous. The third triangle, each of these sections is a triangle shape. Can you see that? Yeah, one and two. And this is the third one. I'm close, hang on. I've done most of it. Not very many more rows to go on this one, just to bring this up to a point. And it's just gorgeous. It's going to be huge. There are three more triangles to go. It's already just enormous and succulent and rustic, and it's done with the Barocco alpacas. It's 100%. No, it's not actually. It's alpaca and Peruvian wool, I believe. So it's got this gorgeous pattern of diamonds worked into the texture. I've talked about all this before. I don't really need to go into it, but I really am enjoying it. The problem I'm having with the green triangle is I'm worried I'm going to run out of yarn before I get to the end. When I knitted the other two triangles, and they're exactly the same size, I ended up with this much yarn when I'd finished. I thought it was fairly close, but not close enough to really matter. I've currently got this much yarn left of the green. That's it. I don't know whether I'm knitting oddly much more loosely, or whether there just happened to be a hell of a lot less yarn in the green skein than there was in the other two, but I'm slightly panicking. Now I know that as you get towards the end, of course every row is a stitch shorter than the row before it, and so towards the end you're literally only a few stitches, and that much will probably do a row. I'm just hoping it's going to be enough to finish. I just don't know what I'll do if it's not. Wish me luck, everybody. This really is yarn chicken of the highest order. Only because if I get to the end of this and I haven't finished, I will have to buy another one, and it's like £12, and I'll only need a tiny fraction of it, and I won't use it again because I'm only using each colour once as I work around the six triangles. So I really, really hope I don't run out. Sadly, I did run out of the dark brown border colour before I got to the end of the third triangle. I was hoping that it would do three, then I'd only use two of these around the whole thing, but that's okay, I've got a third one, it's fine. I was just hoping to keep it for something else. This, however, is causing me stress beyond stress. I think what I probably need to do is leave behind the pattern that I'm working on now and just knit on this until it's done. Then I'll just know either way and I'll stop stressing about it. I do love it. It's going to be very, very heavy and very large. And look, this is how I've joined my triangles together. with a tapestry needle and a bit of sewing rather than, well, not really sewing, but sort of whip stitch, kind of creating loops that way rather than picking up stitches. No colour blips. So that's that. Fingers crossed for me, everybody, please. Now, the final thing I have to show you is my cast on, my latest cast on. This only happened yesterday because I had bought two skeins with the Pewter Casbah for the scarf for Rib magazine. And I had 88, they're quite generous, they're 115 grams, but actually they were 120 when I weighed them. And I only used, can't do the maths, I had about 90 grams left. So I thought, it's so beautiful, I just want to make a hat out of it. It's Casbah sock, if you've never knit with it before, it is so deliciously gorgeous. It's 80% merino, 10% nylon, but 10% cashmere, and it's just gorgeous. It's officially listed as a sport weight, I treat it like a fingering weight. And I absolutely love it. Look at those colours, just look like rusted metal. So beautiful. So I thought, well, I'm just going to knit a hat because the yarn is so soft, it'll be really nice to wear on the forehead. So I cast this on yesterday. It's just a hat. It's just going to be a hat, a nice big old slouchy hat. But look, I love how the colours are pooling and slightly spiralling in pairs rather than just in one go. It's really, really lovely. This is, it's not from a pattern, I just used a tubular, 2x2 rib tubular cast on, which I've never done before, it's a little bit fiddly. I'm very used to doing the tubular setup because that's how I start my double knit scarves, with two colours. This time I did it with just one colour, like a long tail version. But then of course you have some shenanigans to do to make it work for 2x2 rather than 1x1. It's basically the same, you just sort of swap the middle pair of each two pairs, if you see what I mean. So if you've got knit pearl, let's look at it that way, knit pearl on your needles, you would knit that one, then you just swap those two over, then knit that one, pearl that one. So then you've got knit pearl. And then you do the same with the next pair, which would be knit pearl, knit the first one, swap them over, like doing a needleless cable, and then you've got knit pearl. Do that all the way around, it's very, very easy, and you get this beautiful edge which doesn't have a ridge, doesn't have a rim, it's really, really stretchy. And the hat, it's going to be really sort of loose and floppy, and I like that, but it fits beautifully, and I think the colours are stunning. I really, really like it. So this has all happened since yesterday afternoon, and I've got plenty of yarn left to finish it. And I'm not going to shape the crown with spirals or anything like that. I'm actually planning to hide the decreases so they don't all line up, so the hat will just shape itself to a point. But just look at, the fabric is deliberately very loose and drapey. As I say, I treat this like a fingering weight even though it's officially classed as a sport, but I'm knitting this on 3.75mm needles and using magic loop, of course, because I tend to do that. And it's really, I mean, it's, you can see through it, really. Absolutely see what's going on behind it. And it's really drapey and the stitches are quite big, but it's giving, the softness of the cashmere is giving the material such a wonderful drapey feel. Yeah, it's just, it's like, it's light and it's airy, and I love it. Dan, you won't like it. I know this, because it's going to have a bit of slouch to it. But it's just a 2x2 rib all the way up. Works really nicely. And then I just changed to stocking stitch. That's it. Have you ever done the tubular cast on? If you haven't, you basically do the invisible cast on as if you're going to cast on for double knitting, but using one colour, like I say, with a long tail and the working yarn as well. Winding those on the needle. Then you work the first two rounds as if you're doing slip stitch double knitting. So you knit one, bring the yarn to the front and slip one, take the yarn to the back. And repeat, knit one, slip one with the yarn forward, yarn to the back, knit one, all the way through. Do that first round that way so you've worked half of the stitches but not the others. Then on the second round, you slip with the yarn in the back and then you purl the second stitch. And then you repeat that, so you're in effect working the stitches that you slipped on the first round and slipping vice versa. And that gives you sort of as if you're doing the double knitting. If you carried on doing that, you get two sides of fabric. But then instead of keeping them separate like that, because they're still on the needle like that, you then just work around on the third round, doing what I said before of just switching those pairs of stitches so you get two and two and two as you work all the way round, and that gives you this wonderful invisible setup for 2x2. It's marvellous. Not gonna lie, it's a bit of a faff, and when you've done that first twisty thing around the needle for the tubular cast on setup, with this many stitches, I've got 128 stitches on this round, it twists like a bugger. I mean, it was a bit of a faff and a pain to get it started. Once you've worked into this first round of stitches, it's absolutely fine, but up until that point, it's really unstable. It's worth it though. It's really, really worth it. I love how it feels. It doesn't, I mean, look, this is enormous, right? So this is gonna fit any size head. I've deliberately wanted it as big and slouchy as I can. So it's just, wah, 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 wah. That's really, really nice, and it kind of invisibly just your knitting just stops and then rolls around the edge to the other side. Gorgeous, and the colours could not be more beautiful. I'm really in love with it, and I can't stop knitting it. I was, Ben and I, this was what I was knitting on the tube with my sweaty fingers. I just can't stop. I absolutely love it. It's just, I haven't washed my hands since I got home either. So what I'm trying to do is I'm making sure I do my little magic loop trick in the first three or four stitches of every round, so that my anti-laddering trick, which you'll have seen in previous podcasts, so I'm not getting laddered up the side, and I genuinely cannot stop knitting it. I love the feel of this yarn through my hands. I love the colours. I love the way it evolves. I love the way it's pooling. I love everything about it. And I'm so pleased that I had so much left of it. This is actually the yarn I got with my birthday money from my parents-in-law. So Ben's parents gave me, I think it was £50 worth of money and specifically to spend on yarn. I was told, under no illusion, I had to spend money on yarn. So I did. Under no circumstances should I buy anything else, and I did not. So I went to Loop and I bought the two skeins of this, knowing that I wanted to use it for the Rib magazine scarf, and hoping I'd have something left over so I could keep for myself. I believe I'll get the scarf back once it's been photographed. I think Eric's planning to ship it back to me, so I do get to keep it. But it's going to be, which is partly why I wanted to do a hat to go with it, because I might be able to wear the two together. They're different textures, but they are the same colours and the same yarn. So all will be well. And that is my last whip of the moment. I don't have anything else. I do want to cast on a pair of socks soon. I've got the rainbow minis from John Dunballum that I'm itching to do the maths so that I can divide the socks that I want to make into six equal numbers of rows so I can use the rainbow colours and spread those out properly. And I also want to make sure that I do the maths to work out, because I want to do a striped heel flap as well. So the main sock will be split into six equal sections as you go up, but the heel flap will also have a miniature rainbow of six stripes on it as well. So I need to just work out the maths and then I can cast those on, and I'm really, really looking forward to that. However, I do want to finish something else soon. This ain't gonna be finished anytime soon, and I don't think any of the others are either. So maybe when this is off the needles in the next couple of days, I'll be able to work on a new pair of socks and it'll be really exciting. That's kind of it, knitting related. There is one thing I want to talk about now, one more thing. I briefly alluded to it earlier on. Today is the 1st of September 2016. Tomorrow, therefore, is the 2nd of September 2016. Now that's a very important anniversary. 350 years ago tomorrow, 2nd of September 1666, was the day that the Great Fire of London started. Now this is a really, really important date in this household, because the Great Fire of London was documented by the diarist Samuel Pepys. Many people will know that he dug a hole in his garden and hid his wine and his Parmesan cheese in it to protect them from the fire. His house was actually untouched, but he didn't know that. In fact, these books here on the mantelpiece are the diary of the great man himself. My husband, the wonderful Benjamin Till, composer extraordinaire, has written a piece of music called the Pepys Motet. Now, a motet is, in this case, a 20-part choral piece with no instrumentation at all, just 20 voices on 20 solo lines. So it's not like five soprano, five altos, five tenors, five basses, all singing the same things within their part. 20 individual lines all harmonising together and working in. And all the text is drawn from the diary. And we're launching it tomorrow. So we're actually getting a gathering of some of the cast who sang on it round tonight to listen to it. We went out today and bought some speakers, which was why we were in town. And when I was knitting with my sweaty hands, it all ties in. And we're getting together, we're going to listen to it tonight and have some nibbles and stuff. But it is available to buy from tomorrow. And you can purchase your copy, if you are interested, from benjamintill.com/shop. There's different rates, so it's £10 for the CD, there's different rates of postage depending on where you are in the world, but there are buttons on there that you can buy with PayPal. I urge you to give it a listen. It's an extraordinary piece of music. It's unlike anything you've ever heard. It's choral music, as I say, but it's bordering on, it's kind of classical music, but kind of very much not. It's not your fuddy-duddy classical music. It's very rich, very intense, very complex, but very tonal, very tuneful. And it's really, really fascinating. The album also includes Oranges and Lemons, which is a piece of music Ben wrote many years ago for, well not many, 5-6 years ago, for choir and the bells of London. So all of the bells that are mentioned in the churches in the longer version of Oranges and Lemons were recorded individually by Ben and his sound engineer and placed into the score. So the choir and the Bells of London are all singing to put this piece together called Oranges and Lemons. But it's the anniversary of the Pepys issue, as in the Fire of London, tomorrow, that we're commemorating with the launch of this. And should you wish to have a listen, then you can do. In fact, why don't I play you a little snippet now of a film that Ben put together of the Movement 4, entitled The Great Fire of London. Here it comes.
September 2nd, 1666.
Jane called us up about 3 in the morning to tell us of a great fire in the city. She hears about 300 houses have been burnt down, everybody endeavoring to remove their goods
and flinging into the river. Bringing
them into light as they lay.
And the poor pigeons were loath to leave their houses, but hovered about the windows and the balconies till they were burned, burned their wings and fell down.
But the wind mighty high and driving it into the city, and everything after so long a drought proving combustible.
See what I mean? It's not classical. It's unlike anything you've ever, ever heard. I love it. It's really, really exciting. And I'm singing on it, of course, because Ben always gets a free baritone. He doesn't have to pay this one. So yeah, if you are interested in that, if you've come across any of Ben's other music and enjoyed it, and if you feel that you missed out on brass because you lived overseas or couldn't get to London to see the shows last weekend and want to have a little fix of the music of Benjamin Till, then why not pop over to his website and purchase your copy today of the Pepys Motet, including Oranges and Lemons, sung by the Rebel Chorus. There we are. I've waffled on quite long enough today. We better get ready because I've got to clean up this disgusting house, got to hoover everything and tidy the bathroom and clean up the kitchen and all sorts of things. So while this podcast episode may be a finished object, remember life is a work in progress. Just take it one stitch at a time. I wish you happy, happy knitting, and until next time, bye-bye.